Hello and welcome to Just Have Another Think, our twice monthly look at the ecological, environmental and social issues that we're facing as a consequence of the 21st century climate emergency. In December last year, the highly respected medical journal The Lancet published a comprehensive paper looking at health and climate change. The research was carried out by an international collaboration called Lancet Countdown, a global monitoring system dedicated to tracking what they describe as the emerging health profile of the changing climate. The report covers 43 indicators across five sections. That's way too much for a single video, of course, so today I'm just going to have a think about those impacts, exposures and vulnerabilities, which are closer to all of us than we may think. According to the Lancet paper, the changing climate threatens to undermine the past 50 years of gains in public health, disrupting the well-being of communities and the foundations on which health systems are built. It impacts the food we eat, the air we breathe, the water we drink, and increasingly in many areas, the shelter that our societies depend on. Climate change doesn't care if you live in a hut on the Bangladeshi coast or a multi-million dollar condo in California, but the ability to recover from the damage and destruction is really showing up the inequities around the globe, with vulnerable populations affected more frequently and with a more long-lasting impact. Increasing temperatures and heat waves mean that some people already live in regions at the limits of human habitation today. The Lancet charted heatwave exposure in numbers of people days, measured in billions from 1980 to 2019. It's not difficult to see that there's a very obvious upward trend over the last decade. India overtook China by some margin in 2019 as a result of a month-long heatwave that was one of the hottest and longest since that country began recording weather reports. Churu in Rajasthan hit a temperature of 50.8 degrees Celsius, which is just over 123 Fahrenheit. Extreme droughts and water shortages across India and Pakistan caused reservoirs to run dry, depriving millions of people of fresh drinking water. Those temperature levels obviously cause higher levels of heat stress and heat stroke, but they also affect cardiovascular and respiratory systems, especially in people working outdoors or in non-cooled environments, and in people older than 65 years of age or those with disabilities or pre-existing medical conditions. Annual heat-related deaths around the world have almost doubled in the last two decades. The Lancet research data suggests that the global average heat-related mortality per year in people older than 65 increased by nearly 54% between 2004 and 2018, when nearly 300,000 people died from heat-related illness. And it's not just a problem somewhere far away either. More than 100,000 of those deaths were in Europe. In fact, the European region was the most affected of all the regions monitored by the World Health Organization. And from a hard-nosed economic point of view, the picture isn't much brighter either. According to the report, a potential 302 billion work hours were lost in 2019, 103 billion hours more than in the year 2000. Once again, India is the worst affected country in this category, mainly due to its high numbers of agricultural manual workers. But even in high-income countries like the United States, there's been an uplift, particularly in sectors like construction. The Lancet study compared the risk of wildfires during the period 2001 to 2004 with the risk between 2016 and 2019. In no fewer than 114 countries, the risk had increased. And then there's extreme drought. The Lancet research found that in 2018, there was a larger number of exceptional drought events affecting all populated continents, and the global land surface area affected by an excess number of months in drought was more than twice that of the historical baseline. From 1990 to 2019, the Lancet found what they described as clear, significant increasing trends in the number of occurrences of water-related disasters. And here again, global inequality reared its ugly head. In countries that had a reduction or minimal increase in healthcare expenditure between 2000 and 2017, there was a significant increase in the number of people affected by extreme weather events. But in countries with the greatest increase in healthcare expenditure, the number of people affected actually went down, despite an increasing frequency of events. Climate change is tending to make dry areas drier, but it's also making wet areas wetter. And when the rain does come to those regions, it falls in huge deluges that cause localized flooding. And those floods can obviously injure or even kill humans and animals that get caught up in the water or hit by debris. But an even bigger impact comes from the spread of waterborne infectious diseases, just to add to the already existing problems of airborne and foodborne disease. All the diseases tracked by the Lancet Countdown team show an increasing trend from their historical baselines. One important function of climate change that the Lancet report has already identified is the fact that a warmer atmosphere is reducing the altitude barrier to malaria transmission in densely populated highland locations in four of the five regions where malaria is endemic. Between 2015 and 2019, there was a 39% increase in African regions and a 150% increase in the Western Pacific compared to the 1950s baseline. And among other things, those pesky mozzies can also transmit dengue, with symptoms including high fever, vomiting, muscle and joint pain, and a nasty skin rash. And in extreme cases, patients can experience bleeding and dangerously low blood pressure. The paper found that 2018 was particularly favourable for dengue, with a global rise of nearly 9% in a strain called A. aegypti, and a 15% rise in A. albopictus, compared with a 1950s baseline. Dengue is not all that common here in Europe, but nevertheless, we still saw a 26% rise in A. aegypti and a 41% rise in A. albopictus. And then there are nasty little things called Vibrio bacteria, which live in certain coastal areas and that generally come out in force between May and October when the waters are warmer. They can cause a variety of symptoms in humans, including gastroenteritis, wound infection, sepsis and cholera, sometimes leading to hospitalisation, intensive care, and in severe cases, even limb amputation. Most people pick up the Vibrio bacteria either by exposing open wounds as they swim in infected waters, or by eating undercooked seafood, especially oysters. The Lancet research showed that as our seas and oceans have warmed, the coastal areas containing Vibrio bacteria have increased by more than 50% in the northern latitudes in the last 5 years, compared with a 1980s baseline. Along the Baltic coastline, that number is more than 60%, and the Atlantic northeast has seen an increase of almost 99%. One of the main targets of the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals is to put an end to hunger. We currently produce more than enough food to feed our global population, but as I'm sure you're only too well aware, most of it gets hoovered up by those of us living in the rich industrialised nations. And we're so mind-bogglingly wasteful that we actually throw away 30% of all our food, while the number of undernourished people around the world is projected to increase to more than 840 million by 2030. According to the Lancet Countdown research, climate change threatens to exacerbate this crisis still further, with rising temperatures, climatic shocks and ground-level ozone affecting crop yields, and sea surface temperature and coral bleaching affecting marine food security. As usual, these effects will be experienced unequally, disproportionately impacting countries and populations already facing poverty and malnutrition, and exacerbating existing inequalities. The report found that the yield potential of the four staple crops, maize, wheat, soybean, and rice, continues to decline in most individual countries and as a global average. Maintaining global production is becoming more and more difficult because of the changing climate. 2019 saw a global average reduction of about 9 days in crop growth duration for maize relative to the 1981 to 2010 baseline. That's a 6% decrease. Wheat growth duration dropped by 6 days or 5%, and soybeans and rice were both down by 2 days or about 2%. They may not sound like dramatic numbers right now, but climate change is causing that trend line to continue in a relentlessly downward direction. A large proportion of the global population, especially in low-income and middle-income countries, is highly dependent on fish sources of protein and omega-3 oil to help prevent cardiovascular disease. Between 1990 and 2017, diets low in seafood omega-3 increased by nearly 5% globally, with more than 70% of countries seeing a rise in exposure to this risk factor. In 2017, 1.4 million cardiovascular deaths worldwide were attributed to diets that were low in seafood omega-3 fatty acids. The report points out that rising sea surface temperatures are harming marine populations through numerous mechanisms, including the bleaching of coral reefs and reducing oxygen content. What it doesn't say, but I'm going to add anyway, is that the impact of climate change on the marine ecosystems around the world and on subsistence fishermen in many of the affected areas is greatly exacerbated by the breathtaking scale of industrial fishing and the ruthless efficiency of the machines we humans have created to literally hoover up unsustainable quantities of fish species from our seas. Addressing those problems will require major systemic overhauls of how we manage fisheries with far more stringent conservation measures, something we'll look at in more detail in a future video. On our current trajectory, estimates for the average global sea level rise by the end of the century range between 1 and 2.5 metres, and in some regional coastal areas, projections rise as high as 5 metres. Based on the population distributions in 2017, the Lancet suggests that the lives and livelihoods of 145 million people will be threatened by a 1 metre sea level rise, and at 5 metres that number shoots up to 565 million. The consequences of those effects on the health of the folks living in those areas will depend heavily on mitigation and adaptation policies implemented by their governments, and sadly on mass migration strategies that'll need to be agreed between different states and even between nations. And we've all seen how well refugee migration has been going in recent years. According to Lancet Countdown research, by 2020, there were 43 national policies across 37 countries that connected climate change with migration. 40 of those policies also explicitly referenced health or well-being. There was a general acceptance in all the policies that mobility would have to be both domestic and international, but very few of them made any mention of what happens to people who are simply unable to move from their current locations for whatever reason. The options for those folks would appear to be extremely limited, and none of them are good. So, in a nutshell, that's the first section of this comprehensive report. Essentially, we've got a warming world that's affecting human health both directly and indirectly and putting already vulnerable populations at a high risk. Extreme weather events are worsening global crop yield potential and increasing the transmission of infectious diseases. The Lancet Countdown team argue that the data described in section 1 of their report provide a compelling justification for an accelerated response to climate change. There are clear limits to adaptation, they say, necessitating increasingly urgent interventions to reduce greenhouse gas emissions. So how will our societies, our governments, and our health systems adapt to meet these increasingly urgent deadlines? Well, that's something we'll take a look at in the next Just Have Another Think video in a couple of weeks' time. In the meantime, I'll be back this Sunday with my regular Just Have a Think programme, looking at the latest technological developments that might just help us reach some of those climate mitigation goals. See you then.